You're watching Reality Check. If the Delhi police charge sheet into the Delhi riots is to be believed, then a municipal councillor, a bunch of student leaders from Jamia and JNU, two young women who run a group that seeks to provide equal rights to women who live in university campuses, have all got together to try and topple an elected government, to bring, as the charge sheet puts it, India to its knees. Into this tapestry of names, a new name has surfaced. Salman Khurshid, senior Congress leader, has now become the highest ranking political figure and critic of the government to join the ranks of many, many other government critics whose names are now featured in the charge sheet. These are the main points that the charge sheet says about Salman Khurshid. It says that Salman Khurshid, according to a witness named in the charge sheet, gave provocative speeches. There are no details, though, of what these provocative speeches were in the charge sheet, either citing the witness or the police's own independent evidence. The witness reportedly gave the statement before the magistrate under section 164. The police concealed the identity of the witness who names Khurshid and other netas, raising the question whether the Delhi riots probe is justice or vendetta. So this is what the question that the charge sheet raises, the kind of allegations that have been made, as I just mentioned, about the kind of conspiracy allegedly that was framed by those behind it. And that's what we're asking: is the riot charge sheet a fact or fiction? It says, from the day that the results of the 2019 parliamentary elections were declared, the tone and tenor of the public utterances of the key conspirators of the present case has shown a clear streak of affinity towards violence, which has started playing out in their minds. Conspirators aimed at bringing the government of India to its knees and enforcing the withdrawal of the CAA by timing the execution of their conspiracy with the visit of the US president, thereby hitting two birds with a single stone. The end objective of all conspirators was to uproot a lawfully elected government by sheer use of engineered, vicious and visceral communal violence. So that's the question now about whether this entire charge sheet has become more a case of a witch hunt. And let's put up the screen the names of all those who have now been either accused or arrested or named. An absolute canvas of names of the government's critics are there in front of you on the screen, from Yogendra Yadav to Harsh Mandal to Chandrasekhar Azad to Apurva Nand, Jayati Ghosh, Sitaram Yachuri, Rahul Roy, Brinda Karat, Kavita Krishnan, Kamalpreet Kaur, Gohar Razan, Prashant Bhushan, and now Salman Khurshid joining those ranks. And also Safura Zargar, Miran Haider, etc., etc. These are all the student activists who have been named. And of course, as we know, not named are BJP leaders like Kapil Mishra and so on, who were actually seen and heard giving openly insightful speeches. So I had a chance to speak to Salman Khurshid earlier today, where I asked him about the charges against him in the Delhi police riot charge sheet. Did you, in fact, give a provocative speech during the CAA-NRC protests, as the charge sheet appears to allege?
That's a very complicated question. If they think a provocative speech is a criminal offense, then I can't be incriminating myself, frankly. But having said that, a provocative speech is a provocative speech. I don't see anything in the Indian Penal Code that says that you cannot make provocative speeches. Mm. And then they go on to say that it mobilized people. It mobilized people to do what? I'm not quite sure. It mobilized people to fight for their lives, for their causes, fight for their rights. They must come clean on that. And they must tell the world that fighting for rights has now become a crime in this country. And if I went to speak to these people at the site of protest, did I go to sing lullabies to them and put them to sleep? Or did I go to say that I stood by their cause? And standing by the cause in this country has become a crime. This is news to me. And this would be news right. to the Supreme Court of the country as well.
But just to put this in perspective, just so that we understand exactly what happened here. So I take it that you went and addressed some gatherings during the time of the CANRC protest?
Of course I did. Of course I did. And it was my duty to have done so.
Okay.
In fact, I'm not the only one. Many people went, and I believe
and what did you
everybody
say?
Who went did it as part of their democratic assertion of their democratic rights.
So do you recall what exactly it is you said?
I have no idea. I would have said something sensible, but something sensible is unacceptable to this government. I would have said, and I've written a book about the CAA, I would have said what I've said in my book, that the CAA right. was an attack on the constitutional rights of our people, and that people have a right to protest, and that's what I would have said, that you have a right to protest, do it peacefully, do it in a constitutional manner. Remember that the entire CAA protest was premised on the understanding of the Constitution and the preamble of the Constitution. Now, it's disgusting in right. the least for people to be reacting in this manner against the rights of people enumerated in the Constitution.
Now, Mr. Khurshid, the charge sheet merely names you. It is not said that you are an accused. It is based on the statement of a witness whose identity has been concealed, according to the police. But the statement has been given under Section 164, which as a lawyer you would obviously know is before a magistrate, so that's believed to carry greater legal weight. Does that concern you? Because some would see that these are indications of a precursor where the police names people, hints that they may have also been part of the riots conspiracy, as a precursor towards taking stronger action.
Well, I mean, if they want to, they are welcome. But it would be interesting that after 17,500 pages, all they have reached is a precursor, that they have still more to do. But to tell you the truth, I consider the part of the charge sheet, i.e. the attachments to the charge sheet in which my name figures, I consider that to be a heap of trash, and trash it will remain. And I don't think they can do very much with it. If they had anything in their mind that what has been said is purposeful and is adequate and it's evidence, they would have acted upon it. They haven't acted upon it, so I don't see why anyone should worry. But given the kind of attitude these people have, I imagine that nothing is beyond their capacity. And therefore, to be vigilant is something that is necessary to remain free in this country.
Okay, Salman Khurshid there speaking to us, calling it a trash charge sheet. Now, we actually were looking online for examples of what could that speech have been that Salman Khurshid gave. And we actually found an example. This was a clip uploaded by the news agency ANI of a speech where Mr. Khurshid was addressing students at a sit-in against the CANRC outside Jamia University sometime in January of this year. Now, in that speech, he repeatedly refers to Ayin. Now, Ayin in Urdu apparently means constitution. Let's listen.
वो लोग भी जो हमारे मुखालफीन हैं, वो लोग भी आईएन का नाम लेकर ही हम पर हमला करा करते हैं तो हम जवाब देना चाहते हैं आईएन हिफाजत किया करता है आईएन हमला नहीं कराता है आईएन इज्जत दिलाता है इज्जत दिलाता नहीं है कभी हमें आईएन का सबक देना है हुकूमत को आईएन का सबक देना है.
So Salman Khurshid, they're saying that Ayin or the Constitution is something which should not allow to be damaged, which we should respect, and that we should teach the government a lesson of the Constitution. Remember, this is just one clip of the speech. We don't have the whole speech, so we don't know all that he said. We don't even know if this is the speech that is being referred to in the charge sheet, because the charge sheet gives no details. Shahdan Farasat, the advocate Supreme Court, is with us. Desh Ratan Nigam, political analyst, supports the RSS, is with us. AK Jain, former DGP Uttar Pradesh, is joining us on the show. Now, Shahdan Farasat, what do you make of this latest introduction of the name of Salman Khurshid? He's not been accused. He's just been named in the charge sheet by this witness whose identity has been concealed, saying that he gave a provocative speech.
Yeah, I find this, I think the whole investigation, the way they have done it, has really become a joke. And I'm not using that word lightly. I think it really has become a joke. You see, to say somebody was inspired by a speech without identifying that person, without identifying what the speech was, and then, just putting the name callously in a charge sheet, although not making the person accused, what is the purpose of that? And this is not just in the case of Mr. Khurshid. This is the same modus operandi for Mr. Yechuri and some of the other sort of opposition leaders, etc. So I just think it's not worth the paper on which it is written. It, of course, will not mean much in court. If it's based on even a statement under 164, that he was inspired by a speech, but the details of that speech are not available. I can understand the identity of the witness for some reason is not disclosed. But what about the speech? The details of the identity of the speech should have been there. Which speech inspired him? And that should have been there in that 164 statement. On what date or some detail of that. So this just all over the place. It doesn't mean anything really in a court of law. But I don't know what the Delhi police is going at. But whatever they are going at, they're just making themselves look not like a professional investigative agency at all.
Deshata Nigam, increasingly is it becoming clear that this is become an exercise which is just being used to settle political scores, to go after those who are critics of the government with very little evidence or evidence that is frankly not even standing the scrutiny of the courts? Because as I mentioned in my introduction, if you summarize the gist of the charge sheet, this is exactly the BJP RSS narrative that they're trying to build up. But look at, in a sense, how ludicrously it's been framed, that some JNU Jamia students, a municipal corporator, got together to bring India to its knees.
Let me put the facts very clear. If you read the charge sheet, there is a clear military position in riots, recce, planning, organization, command and control structures, which have been there, and the groups were working on coordination. The police has been able to link the Shaheen Bagh protests to the Chand Bagh area in the northeast, the riots that took place. And they have tried to connect the various chinks and various dots. Now, so far as the names of Salman Khurshid and others have come, they have come under a statement under 164 CRPC. 164 CRPC is done before a magistrate who gives an oath to the person and asks various questions, whether he is giving it voluntarily or it can be used against him. So it is all under an oath, and therefore once the name comes, they are bound to be included. Police is bound to include it if those names come out. So whether it is proven or not.
But what is the purpose of... My point is, I know what 164 statement is, but I'm saying that this is... Just consider, as a lawyer, just imagine what is being asserted here, that somebody made a provocative speech. You're making this in the context of a charge sheet which is trying to build up a case for a conspiracy behind the riots. Surely the basic diligence would be to tell us what the speech said. Even that is missing.
So the fact is, maybe one of the person is a protective witness, and if they disclose what speech, whether it was given in public, whether it was given in close quarters, is a very relevant thing, and probably they will have to at some stage disclose that speech and the time and the place and everything. Right now, probably because of the protected nature of the witnesses and he cannot be identified, maybe, but ideally it should have been given, one.
Right.
And secondly, under 164, the statements, as I said, is before a magistrate under an oath, and he has explained all the consequences. It is not before a police officer. So You have, and once the name comes out in disclosure,
it is bound to include it. I understand it's before a magistrate, but I'm just saying it seems to be, without telling you what the speech said, it seems to just be more an attempt to name somebody and implicate somebody who's just yet another political critic of this government. Anyway, let me just go across to you, DGP sir.
Let me add one thing.
Because, let me just go to Jain Saab and then I'll come back to you, Deshratan, because I need to keep the strike moving. Jain Saab, you know, to be honest, I know the Delhi police has come under a lot of fire for this, but I don't actually blame the Delhi police. I mean, the Delhi police, like all police forces, has its strengths and weaknesses, but it's largely a professional force. I think for them to run an investigation which is so blatantly one-sided, which completely ignores open public evidence against members of the ruling party who gave insightful speeches and just go after the critics, is doing its reputation no good. Even people like Julio Ribeiro have spoken out. What are the kind of pressures you think that the Delhi police is acting under to conduct an investigation like this?
I don't know whether Delhi police is working under some political pressure from central government. But one thing I can say, the charge sheet has been submitted by Delhi police and the court. And it is up to the court that if they find that the investigation is lacking on certain points, they can ask the investigating officer to investigate again on those points, or they can return the charge sheet if they feel that justice has not been done. So that option is always before the court. And I think court will examine all the documents. Court will examine the charge sheet, and then they can certainly raise questions as to why the names of BJP leaders have not been included. Salman, Khurshid, Kavita Krishnan, all these people, they have not been named as accused. They have been named as giving provocative speeches at a scene of crime.
Yes.
So I don't think they are just trying to build up their case as to what led to such massive riots. But they have not named them as accused. But if court wants, court can issue notices to Salman, Khurshid, Kavita Krishnan.
They may not name them as accused.
Yes.
Hold on. Sir, the point is they have not named them as accused, but they have named a whole bunch of other people as accused. Again, on the basis of the fact that they gave provocative speeches or statements. These are all people just from one side. It's as if the other side gave no speeches at all, number one. Number two, when you say let the law take its own course, when you arrest people, so many people, student leaders, etc., it has a chilling effect, does it not? I mean, this is not just a case of simply waiting for the course of justice to unfold. This can have devastating consequences on the lives of those people who have been arrested and over anybody who might share a similar view about the CA or NRC. That's the problem. Moreover, when you say let the courts share their view, these are some of the things that the courts have been saying on the Delhi police evidence. When they've been granting bail to many of these people, that they failed to produce any material, that the speeches instigated women of a particular community, no direct evidence attributable to the accused have been found, facts of the case revealed the accused were merely protesting against the NRC CA and did not indulge in any violence, the investigation seems to be targeted only towards one end. Police have failed to point out the probe into the involvement of the rival faction. This is the point, Deshratan Nigam, which remains baffling to us day after day about the completely one-sided nature of this.
See, let me
I
tell
mean,
you,
what about Kapil Mishra? See, what about Anurag Thakur? What about Parvesh Verma?
See, the fact is, once you have to establish the proximity of the speech with the riots, and that is one of the important points. And now, Kapil Mishra's case, let me be very clear, I've been on your channel and I have said very categorically that he can be successfully defended in a court of law. And therefore, when a charge sheet is filed, there are prosecutors, prosecutors are consulted, and then they give advice, and then the names are included. So to say that this is a one-sided investigation would be a very biased view. Investigations are always open, and one thing leads to the another, and therefore...
My dear sir... He can be successfully defended in a court of law if he was actually brought to a court of law. He's not even been investigated.
Yeah. I knew that you would raise that question. That is why I am saying when the charge sheet is filed, the prosecutors apply their mind whether a person can be charged and there is enough material or not. And therefore, in their opinion, they have thought that the person cannot be charged. However, if anybody is aggrieved, there
you
is a
this?
Remedy
you,
available.
You know that this is the prosecutor's opinion? You have information about this, that the prosecutor has looked into the case
general,
of all these BJP
this is the
leaders
process.
And found this
let
unfit?
No, let me answer.
Oh, I see.
This
the
is
process.
The process.
Okay.
I'm telling you the process, how it is done. Now, secondly, if anybody has any
okay.
grievance that a particular police is not doing their job well, they have an option of going under 156(3) of the CRPC and compel the police to lodge an FIR to
yeah.
a court process. Nobody has gone there. Even the people who sit on television channel are completely saying they have evidence, things like that. Please go. You have a private complaint forum also under Section 200 CRPC. But nobody seems
have
to
we,
be going.
Have we completely
everybody,
forgotten what happened?
Every,
have we completely forgotten, my dear Deshratan, what happened when an attempt was made to register a case against Kapil Mishra? Have we forgotten what happened?
No.
To Justice
Murali Dhar?
Anyway, Shahdan Farasan, if you'd like to come in on that.
Please go to the
yeah,
court.
No, I will just say...
They went to the court. The judge who was building up towards persuading the police to take action against Mishra was transferred overnight. Anyway, Shahdan Farasan, yes. Is it premature to call
yes,
all of this one-sided? Let the law
yeah.
take its own course.
No, see, it's obviously one-sided. I mean, more than one-sided, you see, all the speeches of the CAA protesters are basically saying we are exercising our constitutional rights. Now, there is no way if Mr. Deshratan Nigam's argument is that, listen, this can be defended in a court of law, Kapil Mishra's speech, and therefore he was not charge-sheeted. I am not sure how Umar Khalid's speech can be defended in a court of law and why he is being sought to be arrested and put UAPA sought to be put on, right? I mean, his speech, whatever is available in the public domain, is only saying that, listen, we have to peacefully exercise our constitutional right to protest. This law is discriminatory. Mm. It has problems in it. And so I think these are all farcical arguments, have no meaning. But all I would like to say, it's quite evident what the Delhi police is at. They have no concern of who actually committed the Delhi riots. Now, the Delhi riots investigation has become a method to target the CAA protesters, whether connected or not. And this farce will, of course, collapse in court. But by the time it collapses, individual liberty of a whole range of individuals, young people who participated in this protest, will be damaged. And that's the message which the government and the police want to send. It's obvious as that. I don't think there's any other agenda.
Okay.
And because they can't go after the bigger names, they are trying to embarrass the bigger name by just putting their names there.
Can I answer?
Okay. We have to wrap it. Deshratan, just 10 seconds, we're completely out of time.
See, the fact is, so far as Umar Khalid is
very,
concerned,
very quickly, Deshratan Nigam.
So far as Umar Khalid is concerned, it is not merely the speech. He's been considered as, his name has not yet come, a supplementary charge sheet, but whatever is available is that he was one of the conspirators, the main conspirators, not merely speech. They have probably found other material against him.
Okay.
Delhi on 25th February, 6 months in advance, right? Before even the government of India knew. I mean, come on.
That's why I wanted to.
What are we talking about?
Okay. I have to end this. Okay. I have to end this. That's why the moment you open it up at the last, it becomes contentious and difficult to wrap. But we're out of time. Thank you all, gentlemen, so much for joining us on the show. And thanks so much for watching Reality Check. Good night.